While there are some non-negotiable ideas when doing circuit analysis, like physical laws and the passive sign convention, there are also some things that are a matter of preference. It is easy to get so used to thinking about something in a certain way that we start to think it's the only way to think about it. In reality, as long as we're not messing with any of the properties that are absolutely true or universally agreed upon, we can approach problems or techniques in a variety of ways. And there's a good chance that our answers will still be correct. When we're using our comprehensive techniques, namely node voltage or mesh current analysis, it is easy to become so distracted by the details of the technique that we overlook the simple details of what we're doing. Sometimes we get so caught up in the details that we forget the big picture, the proverbial not being able to see the forest because of the trees. Node voltage analysis is writing Kirchhoff's current law equations. Mesh current analysis is writing Kirchhoff's voltage law equations. With that in mind, I'd like to take a look at node voltage and mesh current analysis without employing any specialized techniques. Let's try a simple, straightforward approach to circuits that in some circles would bring the modification of super into the discussion. Let's start with node voltage analysis. Here is a circuit with a couple of voltage sources and a current source. Node voltage analysis is based upon Kirchhoff's current law coupled with Ohm's law. So the method involves writing Kirchhoff's current law equations in terms of the voltages at the nodes relative to a common point. We begin by selecting a convenient reference node. Since ground is already indicated in the circuit diagram, that is our reference node, or 0 volts for this circuit. The 10 volt source is connected to the reference node, but the 4 volt source is not. Rather than do anything special to deal with the 4-volt source, let's proceed with the typical steps of node voltage analysis. The next step is to identify the remaining nodes. With that done, we'll look to the voltage source that is connected to the reference node. The 10-volt source is connected to the reference node. That will make the voltage of the left-hand node equal to the value of the source, in this case 10 volts. The remaining two nodes will be assigned variables. I'll creatively call them VA. And VB. Let's go through the circuit and choose directions for each of the currents that enter or leave nodes A and B. The direction we choose does not matter as long as we handle the currents according to the passive sign convention. In the end, if an arrow was drawn in the wrong direction, the current corresponding to that arrow will just have a negative value. The current through a voltage source has no mathematical relationship or physical law that will help us determine its value. However, we know there will be a current through the source. All we can do at this point is assign the current a variable and deal with it like any other current. If we call it IS, we can go ahead and write node equations at nodes A and B. At node A, we have the current through the 5 kilo ohm resistor and the 2 milliamp current source entering the node, while the current IS leaves. So we can write 10 volts minus VA divided by 5 kilo ohms plus 2 milliamps equals IS. At node B, IS and the current through the 1 kilo ohm resistor enter the node, while the current through the 2 kilo ohm resistor leaves. So we can write IS plus 10 volts minus VB divided by 1 kilo ohm equals VB minus 0 volts divided by 2 kilo ohms. We now have two equations with three unknowns. A third equation can be obtained by noting the difference in electric potential between nodes A and B has to be equal to the value of the voltage source between them. Since the positive terminal of the voltage source connects to node B, we have VB minus VA equals 4 volts. With this set of equation that completely describes our system, we can use algebraic methods to solve for our unknowns. Let's begin by multiplying through each of the equations by the largest common denominator. The equations can then be arranged so that they can be easily put into matrices. Solving the system results in VA equal to 4.71 volts, VB equal to 8.71 volts, and the current through the 4-volt source is 3.06 milliamps. That approach to node voltage analysis completely eliminated the need for a supernode. We simply treated the current through the voltage source as another variable, another unknown, which was added to the system of equations. For some of us, this may be a simpler way to approach problems that have a voltage source that is not connected to a reference node. So obviously, the next question you must have, because all you ever think about is circuit analysis, is, I wonder, is there a similar approach for mesh current analysis? Well, you're in luck. Today, only for the low introductory price, I'll give you two simple approaches for the price of one. Let's take a look at the same circuit, but this time we'll use mesh current analysis. Remember that mesh current analysis is writing Kirchhoff's voltage law equations around the loops of a circuit, but we write our voltages in terms of the mesh currents times resistances. To begin, we will define three mesh currents, I1, I2, and I3. The 2 milliamp current source between meshes 1 and 2 introduces the difficulty when trying to do a KVL loop. Namely, we don't know the voltage across a current source, nor do we have a relationship which will give us the voltage across a current source directly. That's okay. We can simply assign an unknown voltage, Vs, across the current source and treat it as any other voltage in Kirchhoff's voltage law loops. Let's assign a polarity to use for each of the remaining undefined voltages. We'll then proceed by writing KVL equations for each of the three loops. Going around loop 1, starting in the lower left-hand corner and proceeding in the direction of the arrow, we have an increase of 10 volts, a decrease of 5 kiloohms times I1 minus I3, and a decrease of the source voltage. This is a complete loop, so the sum of the voltages must be equal to 0. The second loop, beginning in the lower left-hand corner, gives us a rise of the current source's voltage, an increase of 4 volts, and a drop of 2 kiloohms times the current I2. The remaining equation, again beginning in the lower left-hand corner, starts with a drop of 1 kiloohm times I3, a decrease of 4 volts, and an increase of 5 kiloohms times I1 minus I3. Now we have three equations with four unknowns. A fourth equation is obtained by remembering that the difference between I2 and I1 is 2 milliamps. I2 is the mesh current that agrees with the direction of the current source, so we treat it as positive. We will then arrange the equations so that they are more easily substituted into matrices. Solving the system of equations using a calculator or similar tool gives us I1 equal to 2.35 milliamps, I2 equal to 4.35 milliamps, I3 equal to 1.29 milliamps, and Vs equal to 4.71 volts. We can compare these results to those obtained from the node voltage analysis to verify them. The voltage across the 2 milliamp source is 4.71 volts for each, and the current through the 4-volt source is 3.06 milliamps, if we take the difference between I2 and I3 that we just calculated. We have now handled a couple of the difficult cases that we encounter when using our comprehensive techniques. With node voltage analysis, we were able to handle the voltage source that was not connected to a reference node without employing the word super at all. Well, except to say that we weren't going to use the word super. And we were able to use mesh current analysis when there was a current source between two of the meshes without using anything larger than our small independent loop. The main point is there are a variety of approaches to any particular problem and a variety of ways to think about any of the techniques. As long as we do not violate any of the circuit laws or physical laws, our technique is probably valid. That does not mean a valid technique is useful, however. Sometimes techniques can become overcomplicated or overly abstract. If we do not understand how a technique works, it will be very difficult for us to catch mistakes. Additionally, if we are buried in the details of a technique, we may not be able to interpret our results because we'll have lost the physical meaning behind our results. With any of the methods of analysis, make sure you find a technique that you understand and that you can execute with consistency. It is by definition pragmatism, but by definition pragmatism works, at least in circuit analysis. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.